Okay, good afternoon. First of all, I want to thank the organizer for the session and for accepting my contribution on the agropastoral system of the Bronze Age in the Tolfa Mountain. The data presented here are the preliminary result of a research founded by a scholarship from the Sapienza University of Rome and carried out in the Netherlands at the Groningen Institute of Archaeology during the last month. The research aimed to investigate in a new light the settlement transformation in southern Etruria during the final Bronze Age and the first Iron Age. In other words, if it's possible, study the social transformation through an, a special and economic approach. Through the use of landscape archaeology and land evaluation, the techniques indeed, we intend to reconstruct the agricultural dimension and consequently the demography of the village of this important area from for the Italian proto-history, before and after the so-called svolta proturbana, proturban turn. A great historical phenomenon which led from the polycentric structure of the final Bronze Age, based on hundreds of villages, to their abandonment and to the transformation of the great proto-urban center like Vulci, Tarquinia, Cere, Veio and Volsini, that is the predecessor of future Etruscan society. In order to test the methodology that will be applied in the research, we choose to start from a single case study, the Tolfa Mountain during the final Bronze Age, place of important settlements such as Luni sul Mignone, San Giovenale and Monte Rovello, as well as the area with the largest concentration of archaeological data for the period under exam. This paper intends, therefore, to illustrate the methodology applied and the preliminary data obtained. To understand this community, we decide to describe their agropastoral dimension and see how this is related to the political organization model already proposed for the area, like micro-district, cantonal state, or confederate system. We try, on one end, to articulate the village model in a more detailed way, and on the other hand, we want to test them from an economic and demographic point of view. In this way, we can formulate a more punctual political and social-economic background for the svolta proturbana. The decision to analyze the aspect of the primary economy of the village was dictated by the belief that the subsistence economy is not only the basis and the maximum expression of all the pre-modern economy form, but is especially the starting point necessary to understand ancient society. Examples of this interpretation are found in the works of Timothy Earle, one of the main scholars of the genesis and the transmission of power in pre-state society, as well as the Marxist theory applied to archaeology. There is an inseparable connection between the economic sphere and the society characterized by this. Quoting Paolo Virno, the modes of production are not only a particular economic configuration, but also a set of life form, a social, anthropological, and ethical constellation. Moreover, if we view ancient agricultural production as the exploitation of a common and shared resource, common, we can conceptualize it in terms of social production as theorized by Negri and Hart in their books. A theoretical model was generated to reconstruct the agropastoral dimension of the Tolfa Mountain, employing the land evaluation techniques proposed by FAO and declined for archaeology. Example of this methodology can be found in the research of Dutch school, like the work of Esten van Jolen. Combining information from settlement excavation and palynological and archaeozoological analysis, it was decided to generate a model of agricultural suitability based on a simple arable agriculture, characterized by cultivation of triticum, ordeo, faba and cicera. Since the most numerous paleobotanical remains in this area are the different types of wheat, the particular requirement of this class, that's shown in the table, have been taken as the discrimination basis of the whole model. The agricultural suitability of lands, expressed in a scale from 10 optimal to 1 very poor, was obtained by combination within a GIS system of the factor necessary for optimal cultivation of wheat, the type of soil and its slope, also called the land utilization classes, the elevation of the land, the exposure of the sunlight, and the distance from the water. Each factor was initially considered autonomously through the creation of individual convenience map as follows. Regarding the land utilization classes, because a detailed pedological soil map of the area is not available, we digitalized the geological map 1 to 5 million of the Tolfa mountain and identify the 12 types of land present, some more useful for agriculture than others. The percentage of slope was calculated for each of these soil, starting from a dam at 10 meters provided by the Team Italy site and using the slope function of ArcGIS. For simple arable agriculture, a slope above 30% is not recommended, while a slope up to 10 is considered optimal. Combining these two information, so the soil types and the slope, it was possible to obtain the first factor map. In green, the area more suitable, like volcanic rock and alluvial deposit. In gray, the worst, sand or soil with high slope. Starting from the same dam at 10 meters of the area, the classes of suitability related to the land elevation have been created through the reclassify function of GIS, subtracting a point every 100 meters of altitude to the maximum value of 10. This because every 100 meters of increase in elevation on the mountains, the vegetation periods and blooming for plants are delayed by 4 to 6 days. As concern the aspect, the exposure to the sunlight, ArcGIS provide a whole series of tools that can calculate the terrain orientation automatically. And we use the aspect function, and the whole area was divided according to the land exposure. The value of suitability was assigned according to the study of contemporary agricultural suitability that show how the territory is facing south, in this case the green, get better exposure than the one facing north. Finally, for the last factor considered, the distance from the water, we first generate a theoretical model of the many rivers in the area. The choice to not use the contemporary data provided by the Lazio region was dictated by the lack of metadata able to provide the dam used. And therefore, for consistency with other maps, it was decided to generate the waterways independently using the same dams, the same dam of the other factor map and the hydrological tools provided by ArcGIS. The comparison with the modern water courses was satisfactory, with only two zones of marginal difference, and provided the validity of the simulation. Buffer of 500 meters were generated on these rivers, considering this has the maximum area of suitability for agriculture exploitation. However, to simulate also the fact that too much water is not healthy for plants, a score of 8 instead of 10 has been assigned to the land inside the buffer. Lastly, the final agriculture suitability model was obtained through the overlapping of these four maps. However, because some factor such as the type of soil are more important than the other, as the aspect, for example, a technique was used to weigh each single factor value. We used here the analytical hierarchy process, has been done already in many works on contemporary agriculture. This technique, developed inside the communication science, made it possible to identify the specific weight of each factor with a choice, through the use of comparison scale between single variable. Through the Klaus Gospel Excel template, it was possible to obtain the percentage of incidence of single value inside this model, and so use the ArcGIS function of the weighted overlay and obtain, in this way, the final map as a weighted overlap of the value of single factor. The final map shows the territory of Tolfa Mountain split in 10 classes of agricultural suitability. These classes were interpreted as follows. The first 5 are not suitable for agriculture exploitation. The class 6 is only marginal suitable, and so in this model was considered as pasture. And the remaining classes are gradually more suitable for agriculture, from 7 to there is a clear correlation between the location of the settlement and the higher class of convenience, and this is a first proof of the validity of the proposed model. Once obtained the fields, four steps are needed to define people. First, identify the chronological articulation of the evidence. Define the territories of exploitation of the individual sites. Calculate the agro-pastoral yields of these. Propose demographic estimates from the area under exam. The chronology articulation of evidence of the final Bronze Age Etruria is a subject still widely debated, as shown by the numerous chronology proposed during the time. Without dwelling excessively on this aspect for a matter of time, we will limit to say that the chronology proposed here is the result of comparison between the ceramic production of site with a more general typology that you can show here of the general production of pottery in the walls of Etruria. This is a work made for my master's degree and now under publication. For this work, I identify four phases, A, B, C, D, and the site of in the Tolfa Mountain appear and disappear as follows. For each of these sites, we identify the maximum area for resource exploitation. Usually, the method of Thyssen polygon was used for Etruria. However, as many scholars have shown, it suffered from excessive schematism. So, for this reason, in this work, it was preferred to use a system more adherent to the characteristic of the terrain, a cost surface-based site catchment analysis. This method, used for example by Horn Seober for Crossumerium, provides the use of Tobler function to calculate the displacement times within the territory depending on the degree of slope of the land, and so, as done by Soberts, we use pose the boundary of settlement territories in an hour walk from the center of the village. Signs of settlement are in the order of 2 hours of walking from each other. Cases of overlap between territories are so common. We have chosen, according to the work of Luca Alessandri, to operate an arbitrary division of the territory following this simple rule. If in a subsequent phase a new settlement B appear inside appear within the territory of A, their territory merge together. Opposite, if in a subsequent phase a new settlement appear outside the territory of A and their territory overlap, the intermediate line between these two areas become the new border. The situation of the Tolfa Mountain with regard to the division of land is followed. Once identified the territories exploited by a settlement, it's possible to calculate the agro-pastoral yields. To compute the yields, we used comparison with the estimates of the agricultural yield proposed by Giuseppe Pucci for Arcaico Rome and with the one suggested by Andrea Cardarelli or at the University of Bologna group from the Bronze Age. Regarding the animal yields, instead we consider the estimates proposed by Alberto Cazzella for the site of Coppa Nevigata during the Late Bronze Age and the ones by Claudia Minniti for Central Italy between Bronze and Iron Age. Regarding the agricultural yields generated by the model, we can determine the annual production in quintal of cereal thanks to the number of hectares of classes of convenience between 7 and 10. The assumption is that each hectare exploited produced 3 quintals of cereal in a year. After this, the provision for the sowing of the following year is subtracted from that total to determine the reduction in flour. The flour production involves an estimate loss of 25%, whereby only 75% of the flour is transformed into bread or other form of food. Considering a daily consumption of 900 grams of flour per person, dividing the total grams of flour at the moment, we get the number of daily ration. Finally, this number, divided in turn for the day of the year, return the maximum number of individuals who could feed on cereal-based product. Turning now to the animal yields, this has been calculated as follows. So we assumed that the territory used for pasture are those included in class 6 of the model. The total number of hectares available has been divided for each species according to the average percentage of present attested by the archaeological remains of settlement. Considering that cattle needs 1.2 hectares each A goat or a sheep need 0.12 and a pig 0.2 hectare, we can obtain the number of animals present annually in the village. We consider edible kilos, their protein yields, their ration, and therefore the maximum number of individuals sustainable for each species of domestic animal. For sheep and goats, the milk yields, liter per yields, and consequently the number of individuals was also calculated, assuming that the annual consumption of milk for family unit is 120 liters. Thanks to the comparison between the different yields, it's also possible to find the presence of sites specialized in pastoralism, such as Ceto and Caolino del Fossilieri, and others with a more agricultural vocation, such as San Giovenale or Uliveto di Cancelle. The demography used for the interpretation is the average of people inside the village into the whole area. Science, like all the theoretical model, our model also presented some rigidity that makes it too risky to rely too much on the data of single site. The trend of the population of the Tolfa Mountain during the Bronze Age is shown in the graph, and it's clear that the population of settlement had to stabilize around 700 units, with a slight decrease in presence during the passage between the first part and the second part, and the population decreased also at the end of the period. That we know there are two periods in there was a general reorganization of the form of occupation of the area. In conclusion, the case study of Tolfa Mountain is a good starting point to try to define with great precision the community of the final Bronze Age of the whole Southern Etruria. Through the analysis of their particular economic configuration, it emerged that no settlement taken individually can be considered self-sufficient. This, added to the proximity of the village to each other, seems to confirm the existence of a wider political dimension that, than that of the individual settlement. Within this area, therefore, we can speak of the existence of cantonal confederation between settlement, characterized not only by networks of relationship, but also by a real economic production division, mainly between agricultural and pastoral center, which then shared their products. Moreover, some of elements hypothesized by Francesco Di Gennaro on landscape of power seems to be confirmed. On one hand, as we have just said, the existence of a prevalent equivalence between centers seems to be confirmed. On the other, during the final this final phase of the Bronze Age, the idea of the role, of the proto-urban center had their first manifestation as a hegemonic center of a system in which the peripheral offshore habitants represent successive level of ranks seems to function, as evidenced by some important sites, in this case Uliveto di Cancelle and Monteroello, which continue to be attested in the phase what here referred Bronze final deep. However, the model presented here is mainly theoretical, so one of the future steps of the research is to try to test it on the real landscape, with, for example, survey and sedimental core. It will be also interesting to try to make a model less general, try to calibrate the model with specific crops. And finally, it will be fundamental to extend the chronological range of the work up to the initial phase of the Iron Age, when it's known that the proto-urban model is fully established and the polycentric system described here is abandoned. This to understand the dimension of change that occurred after the homecoming of village society, also as regard the aspect linked to the production of primary research. Thanks for attention, and sorry for stolen some.